Very punctual. I should share now the screen now. Just to make sure that it works. Okay, good. Yes, please, just a couple of recommendations. Please interrupt me anytime. You can raise your hand, or if you feel a little bit shy, you can ask on the chat questions. Maybe I am sure the other people here very knowledgeable about a billion varieties they can answer, in particular Pavel Borovka, who will be leading the exercise session, and he's already there connected. So he is also free. He will be answer if you write on the chat. If he can, if I cannot check immediately the chat, you can also do it live. So you can please ask me, interrupt me, and we will make a little pause after 45 minutes. Yes, I think if I remember correctly, 5 minutes pause in the middle. Okay, let me tell you about. About the course. The course is Prime Varieties and Pre-Map. And my goal of this course is to show you not only the Prime Varieties and why they are useful, I wanted to motivate you the geometry of the Pre-Map, the geometry of the fibers of the Pre-Map, okay? So roughly the plan of the course is today we are gonna just talk about the billion varieties, which is, so today is generalities, yeah? On a billion varieties, and tomorrow I hope we start to talk about prime varieties. So prime varieties are a special type of abelian varieties, and introduce the prime map and prime map, and sorry. And then I decided to go through mainly two papers where they compute the degree of the pre-map. So the degree is just an excuse for me to analyze the geometry. So how these constructions comes about. So one case, we compute the degree of the pre-map from R6 to A5. So I will explain what the objects are. The answer is 27. And the second paper, so this is the paper essentially is Donaghi-Smith and also paper of Donaghi, the fibers of the Pre-Map. It's a beautiful geometry. I hope you will also like it. And the second example is when we want to compute the degree of the Pre-Map. Let me see, 4, 3, I should homogenize my notations. So this is another space called basis. Okay, so there are many parameters here, but essentially both the first case are about double coverings over cores, and the other are cyclic coverings, triple cyclic coverings over a genus 4 cores. And this is the paper of Faber. Yes, and we will see some similarities and other constructions. And in the first case, the degree is 27. And the second case is the degree is 60. And both degrees have a very geometrical meaning, okay? And to end the course, I hope in the last lecture, I would like to do an overview of all the finite pre-maps. And I will ask, state some open questions. Overview of finite pre-maps. So we have a list, a finite list of finite pre-maps. And all this happens in low genera, so covers on low genera. And yes, and we are interested on the geometry of these maps, and more largely, I'm interested in the common denominator of all these finite pre-maps. Okay, let me start with abelian varieties. So, yes, all the material is uploaded There is a list of exercises already in the webpage. So there are the exercises that the Pavel will start to discuss in the first session. There are more exercises. We have more exercises prepared, but to start with this, I think is enough. And all these papers I mentioned here are also uploaded. So you can yourself go and have a look at the papers and check if I'm not saying nonsense here, okay? So try to, and also all the material, all what I'm writing here now, it will be uploaded also. We will save this. So if you want to take notes, take notes. You can also check after. So abelian varieties. Well, I will work all over the complex numbers. Yes, the whole course is about complex numbers. It's enough, it's interesting enough for the complex numbers. And let me tell you probably you know, a complex torus is. So a complex torus A, well, it's a quotient A is a quotient of a C vector space over a lattice. So B is isomorphic complex vector space of dimension G, and lambda is a full rank lattice inside. Full rank lattice. So that means lambda is isomorphic to the integers 2G twice. And there's a complex torus. So an abelian variety will be a complex torus together with a polarization. So let me tell you what a polarization is. A polarization on A, well, easily is an ample bundle, an ample line bundle on A. Mm-hmm. And that's all, that's a polarization. Okay, so an abelian variety is an ample, let me call it L, is the line bundle. So an abelian variety is over C, is a polarized, is a complex torus admitting a polarization. So a complex torus admitting a polarization. So it's a couple AL. Yeah, L is an ample bundle. And so we call here a polarized abelian variety. And so what is the role of this polarization? You see, first notice that V is an abelian group with the sum. So the quotient A inherits the group structure from V structure. So the plus, yeah, from V. So it's also an abelian group. So A is a abelian group. And abelian group. First observation. Second observation is by definition of ampleness. So ampleness, a line bundle ample on a variety, an algebraic variety, is by definition a line bundle such that some power of this line bundle is globally generated, and this globally generation allows to embed our abelian variety into a projective space. Okay, so we know it exists a positive integer k, such that okay, first of all, this is the tensor LK is generated by global section. It's generated by global sections. But even more, there is a power of this line bundle such that the map, I will call it phi L tensor K, defined by the sections of this line bundle. So you go A into P A zero of A L tensor K dual. So what is this map? You take a point in the Abelian variety and you consider a basis of sections of this line bundle L tensor K, and you evaluate the sections on K, homogeneous, this is a PN, oops. Mm-hmm. Right? And it turns out for K bigger enough, that is an embedding. Actually, it's an embedding by Lefschetz theorem that this is for K, oops, sorry. K at least three, it suffices. It's an embedding. So, okay. So the section of my polarization allowed me to embed the Abelian variety into a projective space. So, in conclusion, this is where the thing we had to keep in mind is an Abelian variety is an Abelian group, which is also a projective variety. It has these two features. Okay. So an Abelian. Let me write it down. Color because it's important. So an Abelian variety is an algebraic group actually. It's an Abelian an Abelian group together with the projective variety. And this is given by the polarization. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit more about the line bundles. So now I'm gonna give you a couple of definitions that may sound a little bit fast, but my idea is to show you the different incarnation of this polarization. Because polarization, as I said, is a line bundle, but it has different incarnations. And in order to give you these different ways of thinking a polarization, I need to give you some definitions. Let's denote by peak of A. So that would be the group of all holomorphic line bundles. Holomorphic. Remember that this is also an analytical variety. Okay, holomorphic line bundles on A, and this is a well-known fact that the holomorphic line bundles on A can be parametrized or are identified with the first cohomology group of A of the invertible. So the units of the A of the trivial bundle. Okay, this is a fact. Okay, so let's consider the following exact sequence. So we have a short exact sequence. Consider the short exact sequence in terms of shifts. So you have see the constant shift. It goes into, it's a subshift of the trivial shift over A. Take the exponential, and then you get into invertible shift of functions. So invertible functions over E zero. This is exponential, I think. I think I should write exponential 2pi and then you put here the function, okay? Well, this is a short exact sequence. of shapes over A, and the associated long exact sequence. Well, it starts with A0 of each one, and then you have H1, HZ, and then H1, AOA, H1, A star, and then H2 of AZ. This is the cohomology. And that's right. So the map, the connection map from here is what we call it, gives you the chain class, the first chain class of the line model. So the first chain class of a line bundle here, if you believe me, this identification between peak A and this cohomology group, well, goes into the first chain class of L, is element in the cohomology group of A. Yeah. So this is the first chain class. First chain class. Okay. And actually the polarization, what we call the polarization, I say in line bundle, but actually depends only on the class of the chain class. Yes. So more generally, abelian varieties have a very nice feature. So the cohomology groups are very well understood, actually have a very nice description. So we have this, for instance, the second cohomology group, this is a singular cohomology of A with coefficients in Z, is isomorphic to the alternating group, second alternating group over the lattice with coefficients in Z. Yes, so alternating, so this is the set of alternating forms on omega. So you have, let me write it like this. So you have alternating bilinear forms defined on the lattice with coefficients in Z, non-degenerate, yeah. Well, in general, alternating. Bilinear forms, okay. Actually, more generally, you do it for every cohomology group. More generally, you can identify, we have a map between N alternating N forms from H1 on omega is isomorphic to the Hn of Z. But this fact I wouldn't need it. It's just to know. This is just to tell you that this cohomology group of the linear varieties are very well understood. And this is induced by the coproduct here. So you take one cohomology groups and the coproduct and you end up in it. And they are all like this. And that holds for any N at least one. Okay. Right. Let me. Okay, this is the only thing. So as I said, my polarization will depend only on the chain class. Yes, so it's good to define the image of this map C1. We define NS from A, the image of the map C1 from H1, from associated to each line bundle is first chain class. Okay, this is called the Neron Severi group. Neron Severi group. So it's where all the possible polarizations of A happens, lives, yeah? You pick one element here, they come, so an element here, that means that it exists a line bundle such that the first chain class is that, okay? So, so I'm gonna use this identification here. This is very important to describe what is the image of the Chern class C1? So the question is, which cohomology elements in H2 are actually Chern classes of some Lie model? And this is also known, this is the theory of. Let the E, well, first of all, I define it over V is the C vector space. So let's define an alternating linear form. By linear form. So the following, then the following two statements are equivalent. First, it exists a Lie bundle L on A. Such that the alternating form, yeah, E. That's right. Alternative E is the Chern class of L. So it's represented by this linear form, if only if, well, two things happen. So the lattice, it takes integer values on the lattice, and that we knew, but moreover, is they have to respect multiplication by, well, respect has to be somehow compatible. Respect, so. B. So, okay, and that's it holds for the every B. You see, it's a very concrete way of seeing the Chern class of a polarization. You have a bilinear form, alternating linear form with these two properties. Moreover, there is a very simple exercise, yes? Exercise, you can do it yourself, I think. There is one-to-one correspondence between the Hermitian forms. Hermitian form on V. That's right. And alternating forms E of V times V alternating such that respect is. This is just it's an easy identification. You send an Hermitian form and you send it to the E is the image of this, the imaginary part of H. And vice versa, you take E, you send it to the Hermitian form defined as EIVW plus E times E V. So it's an easy exercise to check this. This is one-to-one, okay? Good. Okay. Now, there's any question now? M too fast, too slow? Maybe it's too slow for the people who don't really know, maybe too fast for them to know anything. But don't worry, I just, you don't have to absorb everything now. I just want to, I have a precise idea of why I'm telling you this, okay? And so they have another one, incarnation of the polarization. And for that, I need to define what is a dual complex torus. Yeah.
I have a question, maybe I should have asked earlier, but in the proposition of the two equivalent statements,
yeah,
you are saying that there is a Lie bundle such that E is the C1 or CN? What's
written? I see one C1, yes. Okay. So, yeah, I have defined only one term class. It's the image of this map, yes, C1. That's right.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. The dual complex torus So, okay, we have our complex stores, and yes, I should say that. I wanted to skip that part, but I need it.
Excuse me, Angela.
Yes, yes.
I wonder if you want to say that the ampleness of a line bundle gives you the positive definiteness of Hermitian form.
That's true. Yes, yes.
Yeah, so actually we know a little bit more in the sense that if you want the line bundle to be ample, you just want its Hermitian form to be positive definite.
Yes, true. Yes, there is a distinction. So in principle, so what I have said until here, it holds for a general line bundle, but they are line bundles such that it could happen that this bilinear form is degenerate. So the condition to be ample is equivalent to say that this bilinear form we wanted to be non-degenerate. Okay, so you are right. So I would consider only non-degenerate cases, and they would be positive definite. Yes, definite. Yeah. So no. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you. But I will point it out precisely. Yes, there is another nice characterization of the line bundles on an abelian variety, which is the Appel-Humbert theorem, but I will skip that. I will just let you know that, should I say it? Let's say it. Sorry. Let me mention that. What is the Appel-Humbert theorem? So the Appel-Humbert theorem gives you an isomorphism of, give you a some diagram like this. So you have on one side the kernel of this chain class map is peak zero. So it corresponds to the line bundles with chain class zero of A, peak A. And the image is the Neron Severi group of A. This is surjective. So Appel-Humbert theorem tells you an identification of each part. So this part, it will be isomorphic to some, okay, I will define something that depends on the lattice. Here we have the quality. And here, with the homomorphisms from the lattice into the, this is C1. So C1 is the circle in the complex norm. So C1 are the complex norm with complex number with norm 1. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's right. So essentially. So you can identify a line bundle in PK is equivalent to give a couple of H. So H is an element here, which is an Hermitian form with these characteristics, and the element Xi, which are called characters, semi-characters. Xi is a semi-character. for H. So a semi-character for H is a map from the lattice into C1 such that with the property that the sum of two elements in the lattice times exponential from Pi, you take the imaginary part from H, lambda mu, okay? So for all lambda, for all lambda mu in the lattice. So in particular, so the elements here looks like correspond only to the characters. Yes. So is H is zero, Chenclan zero, and Xi is the character. So this part you don't have it when it's zero. So it's just a homomorphisms between the lattice and C1, with the C1 is the circle. Okay. So again, this is very nice from William Bright's complex story, actually, for complex story. You can describe any line bundle as a couple of the neuron severity group, as an element of the neuron severity plus a character. Okay. So this already suggests that the peak A, or actually, so you see, peak zero is already a torus. So this suggests, it's clear that peak zero is going to be the quotient of this group. It's in a group modulo the neuron severity groups. It's also a torus. And that will be our dual torus. So let's construct the isomorphism. So you have, let's put omega, the anti-holomorphic maps between V and C. So no anti-holomorphic, anti-linear. C antilinear forms from V to C, call it L. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is a vector space, a C vector space. And together with a linear form, we have a canonically a linear form on here times V to R, which actually just define, just take the imaginary part of this antilinear form of LV, just eat with L, just eat V. And this is non-degenerated. And we can define a lattice via this using this linear form by taking all the antilinear forms L in omega bar such that it has restricted to the lattice, it takes integer values. And this will be the dual lattice. So dual with respect to this linear form, dual lattice two of omega. Mm-hmm. So the quotient, we have a natural torus. We have a quotient. Sorry. We define a hat as the quotient of these forms, modulo this lattice. Okay, so here's the proposition. The map from this omega bar to the homomorphisms from the lattice into the C1. So this is, again, this is the circle and the complex numbers, induces an isomorphism. An isomorphism between the a-hat, the dual complex torus, and peak zero. And for that, we are using the Appel theorem, Appel-Humbert theorem that I mentioned here. Okay, so let's see. So the proof essentially is, so what is this map? You take L, and the exponential of psi p to p. Okay. So since this Berliner form is non-degenerated, then this map is surjective. is subjective. Okay. And the kernel happens to be the kernel of this map. I didn't give a name. Alpha is precisely the dual lattice. Or where you take integer values. If you take the integer values, this exponent is the, this one. That's right. And this is a proof. So,
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes.
This short exact sequence you wrote from peak zero to peak two, the neuron survey?
Yes.
Is this somehow split because you wrote peak zero is quotient of peak A and neuron survey?
Well, you can think it as a quotient of these two. A split will when you say split, I will be thinking of a map from here to here, right?
Right. I mean, since you quotiented by neuron survey, the neuron survey must be somehow inside PKA, right?
Not necessarily. You can still define the quotient. Oh, no, wait a minute. Sorry. This is a. No. Thank you for the observation because I realized my mistake. What I meant is under home. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. That makes sense. Yes. Yes. This is a tortoise. Yes, because you're right. Yeah, but actually, that fact that I don't need. What I need is this. Okay, so what this shows is that that is often. In the future I will identify all things. Yeah, it's often identified. So peak zero, so you can think of the line bundles of trend class zero over A as also a complex torus given by the dual torus. There's an isomorphism. So you can identify them. Okay. So here is my next incarnation. So given this line bundle, a polarization. Oops, I didn't want to change color. For a couple AL, polarize abelian variety, PL, we can always define a map between A and the dual by the following is the stake. So you identify this with peak zero. So you take a point in A and every time you have a point in A, you define a translation to the point. So X, you have a translation. This is a good thing of an abelian group. So you can translate with A, X. And every time you have an automorphism of every variety, and you can define the pullback of a line bundle A. So you have a line bundle here. Yeah, so you can take the pullback of this line bundle. It's a new line bundle, this is also. So I take the pullback of the polarization under this translation, tensor with L inverse. Yes. So under this identification, you see the trend class of the line bundle doesn't change on the translation. So L, DXL has the same trend class as L. This is inverse. And the trend class of the tensor is the sum of the trend classes, and the trend class of L inverse is minus the trend class of the other. So this is a trend class here. Okay, it's an element here. Then it's not so difficult, but this is a nice theorem in abelian varieties that this is an homomorphism of group. VL is a homomorphism of groups. Mm-hmm. Thanks to the square theorem or theorem of square. So the theorem square say exactly that is a homomorphism of groups. You just write it out. Theorem of square. It is not included in the list of exercises, but now I think it's a nice exercise to do. Okay. In fact, this VL is an isogeny. Isogeny. So I profit to define what isogeny is. So isogeny between two abelian varieties or two complex story is a map that it's a surjective morphism. A surjective morphism between abelian varieties. I'm writing. Between abelian varieties of the same dimension. That is an isogeny. So a morphism of abelian varieties. So in particular, it's a homomorphism of groups. This is always an homomorphism of groups. And since it's a homomorphism of group, the kernel, I have the same dimension, the kernel is a finite group. Okay? Actually, it's an abelian finite group. Mm-hmm. More generally, yeah, this is just, I don't need it, but I just mentioned. More generally, this putting a hat gives us a contravariant functor. So hat is a contravariant functor in the category of abelian varieties of the same dimension. So so you have, actually, it's defined in the complex story. The polarization, you don't need the polarization. So for instance, you have a map between two complex story. So that is for complex story without the polarization, that induces f hat from x to x one in a very natural way, because the hat I defined it via this omega bar that you have. So since I define the vector space as a homomorphism, you can imagine a natural way of defining the f hat also. But I'm not going to go through. Just going to mention that this is a contravariant functor. And it has a relation with the, in the case you have a polarization, you have a nice relation. Coming back to VL, this is another important definition. We define KL, the kernel of VL. So as I said, it's a finite abelian group, abelian subgroup, subgroup of A. it can be also seen as a quotient of some subgroup KL modulo the lattice. So where KL is, sorry, VL, okay, VL is all the vectors in the in V such that the image of the Hermitian form given by the polarization has integer values. Okay. That's right. So here is a remark is that this Mafi L depends only on the first term class L. Yeah, on L. So So summarizing. So all the story, what I say summarizing is to tell you these incarnations of the polarization. So a polarization different. Incarnations of a polarization L on A. You have a first trend class of a line bundle, ample line bundle. L ample line bundle on A. This is one. Second, and I have come the remark, a non-degenerated alternating form E from V cross V to C. Did I define? Wait a minute. In principle, I said over here, right? Such that it takes integer values on the lattice. Mm-hmm. Right, I missed another missing. Mm-hmm. And I know the generated Hermitian form. I think it's time for the polls. Okay, finish this and then we make a smart C with imaginary part of H taking integer values on the lattice. And so as equivalent to say an isogeny, you can give the isogeny to VL from AA dual, which is pick zero. And something I didn't mention until now, a vile divisor. A vile divisor. Because you know, every line bundle, ample line bundle, has an effective divisor, is C in A, such that the points in A, such as when you translate this divisor with this point, is linear equivalent to theta. Linear equivalent. Okay. And this, that in A1, that this set is finite. So the line bundle is defined by the divisor theta. And this is the theta divisor. Theta divisor, that is in the also picture. Theta divisor. So this last condition reflects the fact that I want that this phi L is an isogeny. So when this linear equivalent, these points here, wanna be in the kernel of VL. Okay, and I want a finite kernel so that phi L is essential, is an isogeny. Right, I think I'm not missing anything. So let me stop here for 5 minutes. And I will come back with some precise examples of abelian varieties. So the abelian varieties I am interested in. Okay. Okay, you can. I don't want, I will leave it here.